Welcome to the Tackling Tech podcast, powered by Dyknow. Join us as we tackle all things EdTech with insightful interviews, actionable tips, and strategies that you can implement in your school or district to make technology integration more effective. Whether you're a teacher, a tech coach, or a technology administrator, we're giving you an advantage in your role by sharing stories from people who are passionate about working with their peers and enhancing the learning experience with technology. Thanks for spending some time with us today. Now let's tackle some tech.
Hello, everyone, and welcome back to Tackling Tech, a podcast that shares stories about how you can build better collaboration in K-12 schools in a show that is dedicated to putting a voice to remote learning. I am Brett McGrath, Vice President of Marketing at Dyknow, and I am fired up for today's conversation. Before we jump into that conversation, I want to start with a topic that is near and dear to my heart, and has been a topic that has been a theme that has unfolded throughout each and every one of these episodes of Tackling Tech, and that is about making connections. There is so much opportunity and so many ways that we can make connections. We can do it online. There are Facebook groups dedicated to professional development, to similar interests. There are hashtags we can follow. There are people on Instagram we can follow in direct message. Social media has made the ability to connect with everyone around you so easy. And oftentimes, the hardest part is just making that leap and going to do it. But I can tell you that educators right now that are leveraging social media and leveraging communities are the ones that are winning. They're the ones that are ahead of the curve. They're the ones that are not only taking their own perspective into account when making decisions about how to grow professionally, but they're taking other people's ideas and considerations. And I think that's so important for everyone, whether it's personally or professionally. Getting feedback, learning from others, this is how we all grow in all of our walks of life. And I'm just so excited when I talk to just educators and thinking about how they're learning and how they're getting sharper. And a lot of the times it kind of comes back to these PLNs that they're forming. So I'm really excited to jump into today's conversation because it's going to be all about that. Before we do that, I definitely want to do a little bit of housekeeping. So remember, please, if you're liking what you are hearing on Tackling Tech, hit the subscribe button and leave us that 5-star review. That is so important to us, and we really appreciate you doing that and appreciate you listening. You can find us at Tackling Tech Pod on Twitter. That's a great place to interact with us about the show. If you've got ideas on topics that we should be talking about or have ideas on guests we need to know about, please let us know there. Slide into our DMs. You can also find the latest and greatest content that we're producing at Dyknow on that handle too. So we're managing multiple Twitter handles at this point, but I think we're doing a pretty good job of it. We are also on Instagram. You can find us on Instagram at Dyknow_K12. That is a place where we're really chopping up a lot of these different conversations, blog posts, topics, you name it. We're chopping it up into micro content and we are sharing it on Instagram. Please visit our YouTube page. Hit that subscribe button. I am so proud of the way our YouTube page has evolved. It is really, really awesome resource for all of you. So definitely go check it out. You can always find the latest and greatest content at dyknow.com. That is where we're pumping out new articles, new blog posts, you name it, on a daily basis. And it has been lightning. I am so fired up about the work that the Dyknow marketing team is doing. Shout out to Tierra, Mimi, and Maggie. They are making that happen, and I am so proud of the work that we're sharing with the market, so go check it out. I have to mention our digital events. We're loving it. It's been a great source of feedback. It's been a great source of learning and connecting with all of you. July 10th, 12 to 1 Eastern, Coaching the Tech Coaches Workshop. You're going to want to attend that. That's going to give you an opportunity to get your hands dirty. really work through some current problems and get sharp, right, as you're entering those professional development months. I'm really excited about that. So you can go register for that. Go to dyknow.com. There'll be a banner up top. Click it, register. If you can't make it, we'll send you the recording anyways. So go do that. It's going to be a ton of fun. All right, let's jump into the conversation. So I speak with Bruce Reicher, who's a technology teacher. He teaches kind of G Suite stuff, Python coding, and most interesting enough, television production. So we talk a lot about that. You can tell he is super passionate about the work he does. One of the most fun conversations I think I've had on Tackling Tech recently, just because he is, you can just tell he's really all about what he's doing. He has a new book that's going to be coming out, and he just does a lot of really, really cool work, and he's got a lot of really, really cool ideas. We're talking a lot about how he spent, you know, like the rest of us, he spent his last few months trying to do his job remotely, but then he saw an opportunity within that to spend some more time leveraging social media, connecting with others, being a part of groups, and he has learned so much. So I hope you really enjoy the conversation. I hope this conversation with Bruce really gets your wheel spinning on different ways that you can connect with others to learn. I know you're going to enjoy it, so definitely sit back and enjoy this time with Bruce. Talk to you soon. All right, everybody. Welcome back to Tackling Tech. I am super excited for this conversation that we have today. So I am joined by Bruce Reicher. Bruce is a technology teacher, and he teaches G Suite, Python coding, and television production, which I'm excited to jump into the television production portion. I think in our previous conversations, there's a lot to unpack there. And just reading up on him before this conversation, you know, it says his goal for professional development is to give educators tools that they can use the next day in their classroom, which is great. We talk a lot about that on Tackling Tech. And his goal for himself is to share and learn. And that sharing and learning portion is what we're going to be diving into a lot of, and especially how Bruce has been doing that during this period of remote learning. But without further ado, Bruce, how are you?
I'm doing great. How are you today?
Not too bad. And you are out in the New Jersey area. How is your school about to close the semester? Still got a little bit of time left. Where are you guys at?
Almost. In New Jersey, we start Labor Day and end the end of June. So I think this year we go to like June 19th. And I'm actually in New Jersey, northern New Jersey, and I'm about 10 minutes from New York City. So I'm kind of in the epicenter of the pandemic, and we've been making it through. And it's been an interesting transition from when we left March 13th all the way up to June 19th that we're going to go to, you know, to switch over to the remote learning model.
Yeah, and I think, you know, as we record this, it's the second week of June. How has obviously the area you're in has probably been one of the most hardest hit. Are you seeing some changes for the better in your area of people, you know, going out for walks, or are people mostly, you know, staying indoors still?
I mean, this is definitely, I think, the hardest hit area, not even of the country, but of the world. So we pretty much, they just lifted the stay at home ban this particular week. We're still in like stage one of places opening. And pretty much the last 2 months was stay at home, you know, go for a walk. If the supermarkets are open and other essential places that you go in with a mask and with other things to protect yourselves. But we've pretty much hunkered down and have been at home. And, you know, people do go outside, but it is really just for a walk. And the rest of the time, everybody is home 24/7. And not all, but most people, adults, are also working at home. And as we know, that creates a very interesting dynamic that everybody in the house is home and mom or dad is working while the kids are at school can be chaotic, to say the least.
Absolutely. Totally. It's that dual role of being a parent and also being an educator all in under one roof. I think maybe a good place to start is because it'll help give the audience some knowledge on your background, but maybe why don't you talk us through, there's a cool story you shared of a, before this call, of a basketball coach that I know a lot of the listeners will recognize when you talk about him, but maybe talk about how you got started in just television, radio, the production side of it when you were in college.
Sure thing. I went to college in 1985, and University of Hartford had just gone Division I in sports. So I applied, I went there and worked at the student radio station and did basketball games, football games, you know, everything else in college. And then luckily enough, I went up the road to Western Massachusetts, and I did UMass, University of Massachusetts football and basketball games. And when I arrived at University of Massachusetts to record pregame shows, coaches shows, I was lucky enough, he was only 29 years old at the time, but John Calipari had just come from Pittsburgh, and this was his first major coaching job at the University of Massachusetts. And very interesting to see how, you know, Coach Cal has exploded, you know, from all the places that he has gone. And still to his core, a lot of his assistant coaches are the same as they were at UMass. And, you know, for my teaching career, I went to school for radio and television. I was a kid who dreamed of being a sports announcer and was a sports announcer for 3 years after college. And I never really, education was never on my radar. But, you know, as Steve Jobs said in his speech to Stanford, it's the proverbial connect the dots of you don't know where you're going at the time. And the dots have connected for me, you know, that putting on a student TV show is very similar to, you know, producing radio shows and TV shows as I had done in college, and kind of brought, well, it did bring my two worlds together. And just as enthusiastic as I was about, you know, going and doing a UMass Purdue game out by you in Indiana, I'm just as enthusiastic of being there at school 7:30 in the morning, and then 8:03, my students do a live TV show every single day for the past 12 years. So, you know, same person, same enthusiasm. And, you know, I'm really happy and proud that I found my calling of, you know, doing education. I could take those skills and, you know, teach them to kids in middle school, and hopefully they go beyond high school. And who knows, that one day I'll see some of them, you know, as I turn on the TV, or even today as I'll stream something on the internet, you know, I'll start seeing their names pop up all over the place.
Yeah, I love that context and background, and especially the Steve Jobs quote. That is one that I hold dear to myself, and I think about that a lot as I progress and navigate my own career and professional development. I'm curious, it sounds like this is something you certainly love. It sounds like this is something you're certainly passionate about. How has your role in television production and doing those sorts of things changed amidst, you know, everyone going remote?
I mean, it's changed everything. I mean, the format of the show that we had, every eighth grader in my school is lucky enough that takes TV production as a class, and then three classes in one marking period, which is about a 20-day, every other day period. The kids actually do everything on the show for 14 days. So they're the camera people, the video switcher, the on air, they make the content for the show. And once we went into the pandemic, March 13th, obviously all of that changed, that I don't have a TV studio at my house and I can't have students come over. So what we decided and we've gone to is just more of a weekly show where we still have the student TV show every week instead of daily. And interestingly enough, you know, the content of the show has been amazing because teachers have sent in content, the gym teachers, the music teacher, social studies teacher, along with content that I've had my kids creating in the regular class. And it's really been a matter of what can I fit in that 10 to 11 minutes every week instead of doing the 10-minute daily show. So it's definitely been a change. I think one of the you know, things I think a lot about, and going into next year, if I'm still at home, how can I get more of my students actually on the show? Because at this point, everyone's sending us content. The enrichment teacher in the school, Jonathan Harvey, is awesome. He helps me do the show in the morning. So we've actually taken turns editing, and we video the show every other week because it's a little bit of time to edit it. But how can I get more students actually on the show who are in my own class? So I have a tremendous amount of students' work that's represented every single week. But besides having someone host, which is what we've done so far, how can I actually get more students to, you know, involved in the actual production of the show? Because we're not streaming it live from home. This is all, you know, pre-recorded and pre-production in WeVideo. And that's kind of the point that I'm at now. Like, the content is amazing because we're able to pick the best parts and put it into the show. But moving forward, going into next year, whatever happens, if we are in remote learning or a 50-50 type thing, how can I get more students actually involved in the weekly production of the show?
I love that. And that's actually something that I am working on at Dyknow, is how do I get more of the people that work at Dyknow involved in our content and design. So there's definitely, I can relate with probably your thought process and what you're currently going through. I'm curious, it sounds like you have some learnings just based on your experience working remote of how you can, you know, improve on something that's already going really well. What have been the biggest professional development opportunities for yourself during this time?
I mean, I really go back to Thomas Friedman, The World is Flat, who's a New York Times writer. And for me now, like, the world is flat and it's a total ed camp 24/7. So instead of going to ed camps or coffee EDUs or places where I would have to, before this, you know, drive an hour and a half to a particular place to go for the day and then drive back home, I think, and I really know, people have become so familiar with, send me the link, send me the password, and whether it's Google Meet, Zoom, WebEx, all different types of things, you know, there's a certain comfort level now 2 months later of people doing that. And I've really been able to leverage that in my own PD and growth mindset, that I'm in workshops now all over the place. And to give you a simple example, GEG groups, which are Google Education groups, they're really sprouting up in every state in the United States, and they're very popular in the world. So every Thursday morning at 9 o'clock, I'm in a GEG global group, and there's people from England, France, South America, United States, you know, all these different countries. And all of a sudden, I'm in the conversation as Bruce from New Jersey, talking about whether it's COVID-19 in the beginning or schools opening, and really just talking education with other educators. And again, people are so comfortable with just click the link and meet me. I've had some terrific experiences in the past 2 months of people online, if they were struggling with WeVideo, if they've never used it before. There was a music teacher in Iowa who posted, she just didn't know how to get 100 of her students all in one WeVideo at once singing a song. So I sent her a message on Facebook and said, if you want to meet, I could do Zoom or Google Meet. And incredibly enough, a half hour later, I'm on with her and the other teacher for 40 minutes, and she's sharing her screen with me. And I'm literally going through everything of, don't worry about syncing up 100 kids. If you put in titles and subtitles and credits at the end and some of the other things, it's going to look fantastic. And I think two big pieces of the PD for me is, you know, it's asynchronous that I'm home and everybody else is home. I wouldn't be doing that normally 1 o'clock in the afternoon, conferencing with someone from Iowa, or forget about, you know, people in England or other parts of the world. And again, being familiar with using these tools that maybe 2 months ago, myself included, you know, I really didn't know how to do Zoom at all. I didn't know what any of the buttons and controls were on Zoom, but I think there's a certain comfort level, and educator to educator, which has been amazing. People want to share, people want to learn together and really help each other. And that's the biggest thing that I've seen from my own PD changing, is it's not just New Jersey or where I could drive to, maybe in Connecticut or New York in the area I live in. Ed camps, which are unconferences, there's no presenter, the teachers are presenters. There's tons of virtual ones in the summer. So I could go to Ed Camp Kansas, for example, when I'm sitting in my playroom in New Jersey. It's really amazing. And to me, it is like, the world is flat, and the other pieces, the technology has caught up, where I'm amazed at how clear Zooms, Google Meet, whatever tools people are using, it works pretty seamlessly unless your Wi-Fi drops at home. Most of the time, you know, the audio and video level are actually very good.
Yeah, no, I think that's really good background on how you're becoming a better learner and connecting with others during this time. I think before I jump into building your kind of professional learning network, I want to talk about some the tools. I think that's something that I picked up on before even reaching out to you, that I could see you were super passionate about. You're almost like, it's almost like looking you up. It's like looking at like, you're like an educator NASCAR with all the logos and types of tools that you're into and all about, which I think is fun. So, you know, you're an ambassador to a lot of different technologies. How does that happen? I think that's something just in K-12, you hear a lot, you hear the word, I'm an ambassador of this product, but how does that process work for you in terms of selecting tools, being a promoter of those tools and helping kind of share the how helpful those tools can be to others in their classrooms or situations?
Right. I try to keep it simple for myself, and I'm going to explain to you how I try to keep the tool simple. If I use the tool, then I want to go be an ambassador for it. If I don't use the tool, then I probably will not invest the time in something that I might not use or my school district might not have a license to. So I really think there's something to the simplicity of keep it simple for yourself as the learner, as the teacher. I have three go-to tools: Wakelet to curate all the places online, along with YouTube videos and Flipgrid shorts within Wakelet. I use WeVideo, which lets me do a video, a podcast, a screencast. They just added a GIF maker or GIF maker, however you like to say it, within WeVideo. And then the final one, which is one tool, but a big tool, is just use all Google tools. So between those three things, if you give me Google tools and WeVideo and Wakelet, I kind of call it like my own, you know, big three. That's mm-hmm. all that I need. And certainly there are like screencasting, for example, there are tons of terrific screencasting tools. Screencastify does it. Flipgrid does it. I could name another eight of them, but you know what? I want to keep it simple for myself, where I'm not using tons of third-party apps or websites, even though they might be more powerful on their own, when I could just do everything in WeVideo that I need to do. So I could do a regular screencast. I could put a video of myself on the screencast and really keep the tools simple for myself. And I think this is terrific that every single company in COVID was offering their products for free. So it was terrific to be like, you know, I'm just going to use the best of everything. But for a power user, that's not terrific, because you want to keep it simple. And then 100 times, if you're not a power user, and this happened in my own district, you know, giving people 10 choices to do screencasting, although it sounds terrific, it really is not terrific. You know, a person who's a beginner, they want to know you're going to screencast in WeVideo, or you use Zoom or Google Meet, just record yourself. Guess what? You're screencasting. Like, keep it very simple. And it's very easy, myself included, to get overwhelmed with all of these different tools, because they all have terrific traits about them, to try to keep it simple. And then I work a lot on the TV show and even in professional development teaching. Like, what is my workflow? Like, I need to keep my workflow as simplistic as possible to make it as effective as possible. And just to give you an example, in the beginning, I might have been pre-recording a lot of lessons that I did with the kids, because I wanted to look right and sound right and, you know, all these type of things. And then an aha moment was we started in Google Meet and we started using Zoom after that. I just record the lessons in Zoom. And then after the lesson's over, I just cut it in QuickTime, which is a free application. I trim the beginning, I trim the end, and then put it right up into Google Classroom, which is our tool to communicate with the kids. So whereas beforehand, maybe I would be spending, who knows what, an hour, 2 hours, 3 hours, whatever amount of time to put something together. Now, just within my lesson, when I'm done, within 5 minutes, I have the video created and the video uploaded to Google Classroom for students that might have missed the lesson. Being asynchronous, they might not be there at that particular time. So I really think, you know, the key to it is, if you can, try to keep it simple. And I know it happens, and it happens to myself too, like the big O word is, it's very easy to get overwhelmed. You know, there's so many different things coming at you besides the technology that you're using. You're teaching a lot of classes, and a lot of these tools are new. Even from the point of view, it's new for all teachers. Who sits for 8 hours or 6 hours and teaches? I mean, most teachers are walking around the room, they're walking around the school, they're mobile the whole time. So a lot of challenges to overcome. And I really do think keeping it simple and whatever tool you use, that's the right tool. So you use Screencastify and that's a tool you've used for screen recording. That's terrific. Then go with that. You know, try not to learn too many new tools, even if they were free. You know, stick with what you know and, you know, kind of perfect that and make that better and better.
I love that. And I think the keeping it simple mindset is something that's so important for educators. And hopefully during this time where everyone's had to lean on technology a little more, people have come to that kind of understanding that it's not about how many tools that you have, but it's about it's about using them effectively. And it sounds like just based on the way you structure your technology, you identified yourself as a power user. And I think it's just, for me, as someone who works in an education or a technology company that supports education, you know, at the beginning of this, everyone was giving away their product and everything was free. Well, you know, oftentimes, like you described, that causes more problems for districts when they go back to normal and everyone's been using several different tools as opposed to one. So I think that mindset of keeping it simple, using what you have and getting better with it is certainly important to understand. And I think hearing you say that, that's something that I would recommend the audience think about as they move forward and you move forward in your, you know, planning for next year, whatever the uncertainty is. I think it's undeniable that technology will be a key piece of that moving forward.
To give you like an old sports analogy, like the Green Bay Packers who won the first couple of Super Bowls, they ran one play. They ran one play, but you know what? They perfected that play, and that's the play they ran. That's the play they practiced. No defense could stop that play on the ground, however they ran, you know, whatever running play through the tackles. And I do think of it in my head as the same way. Like, you know, we video Wakelet and the Google tools, that's like my one play. Like, I know those. Now I can perfect them. I can find out other things that they could do. And I'm not spending time looking for all these different third-party things. And that's a sports analogy that I kind of think of is, you know, that was the only thing that they ran. But you know what? Nobody stopped it. So there was no reason for Vince Lombardi to come up with this whole big playbook. He literally had one play that won the first couple of Super Bowls.
Totally. Yeah, that's even simplifying the way I usually talk about it. And I talk about the Tecmo Bowl offense, which obviously is four plays, but one play in the Packers, that's something I'll have to keep in consideration moving forward. And I often, too, in describing it, I think about that 85 Bears 46 defense. It was just simple, but they just did their one job effectively. And that's why that team was so good. So always love to find opportunities to bring up sports in this show. So thank you for doing that. Let's talk about just the process of building your professional learning network. I think that's a hot topic now and something that more people are focused on. So what sort of tips do you have for the audience in terms of, you know, there's a lot of different communities, there's a lot of different social media platforms. What are kind of like what's a crawl, walk, run approach into kind of building and then developing your professional learning network?
I mean, for me, in my professional learning network, I really am mostly on Twitter. I do also go on Facebook, but really those are the two. I've dabbled in Instagram, but I'm mainly on Twitter, PLN, and also on Facebook, you know, with different Facebook groups. And, you know, kind of the same premise, like I would start small, you know, like for me and my PLN, you know, for me, small is like Eric Kurtz, who any tutorial I need, I can go to Eric Kurtz. Casey Bell, the shakeup teacher, I need a guide on something, I know to go to Casey Bell. And get like a core of people, whatever your curriculum area may be, that you're gonna follow, whether it's people, or it could be the math association, the language arts association, whatever big group has a place to go, that's where I would start. And the other thing, and really it is like part of my philosophy, is forget about the numbers. I mean, it's, you know, people say, I have this amount following me, I'm following that amount. You know, the numbers really, you know, don't matter. To me, it's like analogy of like listeners who would listen to a radio show in the past, whether it's one person, 100 people, 1,000 people, 100,000. You're going to do your best and you're going to improve. So I wouldn't get caught up in the numbers. And I think sometimes, especially Twitter, with the way it streams and you go back and you feel like you're missing things, you're not. Like, there is no fear of missing out on Twitter. When you're there is the right time that you're there. So I would start the PLN small with people who you may know, or maybe tech people in your school could recommend if you're looking for tech tool people. And then same thing, find one or two hashtags that you can follow that have Twitter chats. Twitter chats are usually a half hour or an hour long. They pose questions to the audience, and then people write the answers, and they share like that. So every single week, I do one called hashtag Sat Chat, which is educators from around the country every morning, 7:30 a.m. Eastern. Hashtag Sat Chat is one I'll go to every week. And that's really it. There's a couple others that I might dabble in, but I find 7:30 in the morning, nobody is up in my house on Saturday morning. That's when I can, you know, consistently attend and just start small. You know, these virtual ed camps, I would, you know, dabble in and, you know, put my foot in the water for those. And I think your PLN just grows naturally as the more places you go, the more people you'll want to follow and the more people that will follow you. And I really do think it's a special trait that all educators, not only teachers, but every educator has. There's not one person who doesn't want to share things with you and, you know, have you learn from them and having you share things, and they're going to learn from you. And truly, I mean, that's the type of community that it is online and Twitter with my own PLN. Even somebody, Sarah Thomas from EduMatch, has kind of coined the phrase, it should be even PLF, where personal learning family, where it ends up becoming people who you know virtually, and you might meet them at a conference down the line, but they do become, you know, your family and your go-tos, that if I need something and I need, you know, help with it, or I can DM or direct message this person. Kim Matina is one of my other people. She does a show called The Sweet Talk, where she interviews people from all around the world, how they use Google tools. You know, it doesn't matter what number I'm following or are following me. I have a small group of three or four that are kind of like my go-tos. And some of them I met in person, some of them I haven't. But same thing, I would start small. And if you can try to figure out, if you never use Twitter at all, I know there's a good book, 140 page guide to Twitter. It's from a company called Evolving Education. They're actually the host of Sat Chat. They started the Sat Chat 7 years ago. That's a great book that gives you 140 ideas of how to use it. But before you even would get the book, I would say just sign up for Twitter. And the other important point I really think is you don't even have to engage in the beginning. You know, sign up and just follow people. Go put in different topics that you might follow. And that's what I did. I think I've been on for 6 or 7 years. I don't think the first 2 years I tweeted anything. I just found people to follow that I could learn from. And I never really evolved into, now I'm going to share all of these things. Now that we're all home for remote learning, it's a little bit easier to share out tweets during the day when you're not teaching in your classroom. But same thing, I would start small and purposeful. You know, I might not follow someone who, you know, like the National Science Federation. You know, I don't teach science in school, so that might not be a group that I necessarily follow. But for ed tech groups, I would follow, and then just, you know, build from there.
Yeah, no, I love that. And I think just that mentality of, you first, you just jump in, you don't have to even tweet, you can just follow and listen and learn, and having that kind of growth mindset as you are entering and trying to build your own professional learning network, I think is so important. Can you talk a little bit about, because I think there is, when people are joining Twitter or joining these different groups, there's this fear that some individuals might have, and it's the give to get. So can you talk through, like, how you think about, you know, obviously if you follow a bunch of accounts, you're getting a lot of value from people, but then how do you give back, and then with your own personal brand, and how do you balance the two of the give and the get as you're building and developing your PLN?
Yeah, sure. I truly believe that almost all of the educators who are in it, you know, they want to share. And I think it's also human nature. If I go to you and say, Dyknow is fantastic, could you tell me all about it and give me a tutorial on it? you know, you're going to be like, great, let me set up a time and I'll walk you through Dyknow. So I think most people, if you approach it that way in a positive way, are going to share with you. In terms of you sharing things, I think whatever you learn and you think is cool, I would share. And I think sometimes some of the most obvious things, you know, that you might do, for example, if you're on a spreadsheet and you do Command or Control F, it might be to find anything. It makes a little search box for you. You might think that's common knowledge, but I think as more and more people are in these places of learning, it is not. You know, if you find a shortcut how to do something, just say, hey, I found something cool to do. Here's, you know, what I do in 140 characters or less, or excuse me, they give you more characters now. I don't post videos. I don't post animated GIFs of it. I think that's terrific if I had the time to do it. You know, I just post the text. If I happen to have a picture, I'll throw it up there. But I really think whatever is purposeful to you that you're learning, you might think is common knowledge, but those are the type of things, you know, I'll throw out there. And I think the other thing that's important is if you start following different people on Twitter or Facebook, or you're in these Facebook groups, take like Google Tools, for example, the way that I end up following it, you know, something new comes out, like today, I think through Gmail, you could post on Google Calendar. I'll end up reading it 5 or 6 times because a lot of those people are posting new things that are coming out. And I think that also makes my learning easier. It's not like I'm just reading it once and I think it's a great idea. All of a sudden, if you see all these people are writing about this specific tool or a piece of a tool that came out or an update, even I saw this morning, I think like Google Meet, now they're having, it just came out where you could watch the video as you're presenting or sharing your screen. And then you see all the boxes of all the people below what you're sharing. You know, that's a brand new tool today, you know, June 12th, whatever we're taping. A lot of people might not know about that. That would be something that I would share today. And I don't even use Google Meet anymore. My district uses Zoom, but I would put it out there being like, you know what, that's pretty cool. Let me share it with other people. So I guess what I'm saying is what might not be so obvious to you, even if it's in a curriculum area, a project, it doesn't have to be technology, you know, to somebody else, make a year-end video of your school. There's, you know, hundreds of different ways to do it. And schools are doing it hundreds of different ways. Like right now, it's the end of the year for me. I know a lot of people are lucky they ended, you know, the end of May. Like that would be something awesome to share out. How is my school doing an end of the year video? Out of 100 schools, you might get 100 different ways that people are doing it. So I think also looking for some of those, you know, topics that everybody is doing right now would be, you know, awesome things to post. Even going back to school, you know, we could peel the onion and spend another 6 or 7 hours talking about all the different questions that are going to come up with going back to school. That would be, you know, a great topic. So I think the timeliness of it, along with good content and in like tiny little chunks, would be the two things I would tell people. If you share things, again, even if you know it, I think it's really purposeful to people who are on Twitter, Facebook, or any social media platform.
Yeah, this is like the crash course of how to start, build, and maintain your PLN. So I know this is going to be super helpful for everyone listening and appreciate your perspective. I do want to make sure that we spend the end of this conversation talking about the book you're working on. I think that's super exciting. Why don't you share what the book is and kind of your process you're going through to bring that to life?
Sure. And the book is really a social media story. 5 years ago, I connected with Paula Niedlinger, who's a teacher in Plymouth, Indiana, right by Notre Dame. And I found somebody online who not only does a TV show like me in a middle school, but she's aces. She does a radio show. Kids did movie festivals. Kids did media. They made posters, all of these type of things. So 5 years ago, I'm like, this is someone I want to be a friend with on Twitter. We started tweeting back and forth. Our classes have shared you know, our features together, our shows together. Eventually, I met her. She came to New York City for like a radio and TV conference. And about a year and a half ago, she asked me and another teacher, Randy Tomes, if we wanted to write a book together, just because we couldn't find one. You know, a good book on creating media in schools, not necessarily to build a radio or TV station, but just for students to create media. here would be like a guide, a recipe book of all different examples of projects, examples of rubrics, vocabulary at the end that you might need. So we collaborated for a whole year together and wrote the book. And luckily enough, last September, EduMatch Publishing with Sarah Thomas, we signed a contract with them. And at this point, the whole book is written. The final editor and layout is happening. And August 11th, the book will be available on Amazon, Barnes & Noble, all over the place, the edumatch.org website. The book is called Scripted, An Educator's Guide to Media in the Classroom. And the focus of the book really is, if you have any device, whether it's your phone, a tablet, a computer, you are ready to go as the teacher to create media. And more importantly, give your students assignments to create media. If you take a look at future skills of what they're going to be 2015, 2020, 2025, there are groups that do studies and make these top 10 list of skills. 9 out of 10 of them all revolve around creating media in terms of the skills of creativity, problem solving, working with others. There's many more that are in there. And every single one of those skills is a higher order thinking skill that works perfectly with media. And creating media could be you make a public service announcement just as audio. It doesn't even have to include video and to do a full blown out, radio or TV show. So the book, the premise of the book is it's for every teacher K through 12, and you don't need a budget. If whatever device you have or your school gives you, that's a perfect place to start. I know there's a huge digital divide in the country that really, people are seeing more and more now. But even if there was a device like a cell phone that maybe someone has in their house, that's a perfect device to start on, record audio, record video. There are different apps like Clips on the iPhone. There's one called Quick through GoPro that Quick anybody could use, Q-U-I-K, to make like a quick and easy video. So we're very excited, the three of us, being media teachers, being able to share in a book. And of course, one of the things with writing a technology book is it going to be updated as it goes through the process? So we're going to have a website that's under construction that's going with it. And I'm really proud that we will be the first book ever to have a full companion Wakelet site that will go with it. So any new tech tool we could put on Wakelet, people could go to Wakelet with a companion to the book. And the really cool thing about Wakelet, if you've ever heard of it or never used it, you curate or you put all your information there and you take something called an embed code and you could put that right on your regular website. So we really want to make this like dynamic that as new things come out, just like I would tweet about them, I'll put them on the Wakelet site. Dynamically, it will show on the website for the book and to keep everything updated, with technology. So, we're excited and I'm really excited to see once people get the book. We've talked about people going in all different directions. I can't wait to see what people create once they see some of these lessons, some of these tools that they can use the next day in their classroom. And that's really the purpose, to help other teachers. And one final note, there is about none research in this book. So we did not go visit other schools and write a book about media in the classroom. We're talking firsthand. Each one of us have taught for over 20 years. So we brought the three people together and shared our experiences in the book.
I love that. And I think the Wakelet site is super innovative. And, at the top of this, I said your goal for educators is that they can use technology the next day in the classroom. And that is what you just described. So we will definitely be sharing out all the information on your book to make sure our audience has access and can know when that comes out. So I know that's no small feat. So congratulations on your book. I got to ask you, because you brought it up, have you ever, you mentioned Plymouth next to Notre Dame. Have you ever been to, talking sports, have you ever been to Notre Dame Stadium to see a game?
No. And you know what? That's something that is on like my bucket list of places where I would love to go and, to see a game. So I haven't gotten that one yet. I don't know if it was necessarily on my bucket list, but it was very cool. I did travel to Indianapolis last year to work on the book, because one of the authors is from Noblesville, Indiana, right outside of Indianapolis. So I did take a road trip to go there. But yeah, I would love to see. One of my favorite movies is Rudy. So without saying, I mean, I would love to go to a Notre Dame game and see the parade and all the pomp and circumstance and the football game, you know, would be awesome once they get going again. So I have it on my list. I haven't been there to see a game. I watched obviously tons on TV, but no, that's not a place where I have been yet.
I got to tell you, so my mother grew up very, very close to Notre Dame Stadium in South Bend. And so my earliest memories as a kid was my grandpa sitting me down, put with Notre Dame football on, saying, "This is the team we cheer for." That memory has stuck with me ever since. And I've been Notre Dame football fan my entire life. I try to go to a couple games a year, and from one sports fan to another, I have not experienced anything quite like going to a football game at Notre Dame Stadium. It's giving me goosebumps thinking about it. So I hope that at some point in the near future, whether it's this season or next season, that can happen again, because in all of the places I've seen sports live, that is just, there's something very, very special about that entire experience.
I mean, anytime that you bring, you know, over 80, 90,000 people, whatever the number is, together to cheer for any type of event, it's going to be special. And then with all the tradition that's there, obviously it is, it's a special sports place, as special as there is, you know, in the whole country. So hopefully once we get over COVID and crowds could go back, I think on my bucket list possibly now is to go to a Notre Dame game with you. So
let's make it happen. I was the last one I have gone to was, I went to the USC game, which obviously big rival last season. It was a night game, which there's not a ton of night games, big rivalry. It was freezing and Notre Dame was supposed to blow them out. Of course, with any rivalry game, it got close at the end. Notre Dame ended up prevailing, but it was a rowdy, rowdy crowd that night. So, yes, we got to make that happen whenever it can be, you know, it can be any game. I'm always down to make it's about 2.5. They redid the interstate a little bit so I can get there in about 2 hours, 45 minutes. So, yes, let's definitely try to make that happen in the near future. But let's make sure that people know, where can people find you? What's your Twitter? And where can people reach out to you online?
Sure. I mean, the easiest way is on Twitter. My handle is the @ B Reicher, BReicher. So at B Reicher on Twitter is definitely the easiest way to follow me. And if anybody has any questions about media production, anything like that, even breicher@gmail.com. If people want to email me any questions that they might have, or if they're interested in getting more information about the book, we know August 11th is the day that it's going to be out. I know it will be on Amazon and Barnes & Noble. I don't have a specific price yet. That question has been asked to us, but I will shortly of exactly how much the book costs. But at B Reicher is the easiest place to find me, you know, on Twitter. And I think both of us are showing that we're, you know, missing sports after 2 months of watching, I'm not sure what, you know, on TV. I mean, sports watching
reruns,
at least 80% of my TV watching. You're making me jealous talking about Notre Dame football and all the rest. So hopefully, you know, everyone is safe out there, and someday soon, hopefully sooner rather than later, we will get back to some normalcy of sports, because I know I miss it. It's a huge outlet for me just to watch and, you know, take my mind off of, you know, school and other things. And I think everybody in the country really misses, you know, watching whatever their favorite team is, you know, just to step away from, you know, from life, and whether it's baseball, football, whatever it may be, you know, watching, I don't know what sport is on TV because they're all repeats, is just not the same as watching the real live thing, the drama of not knowing, you know, what's going to happen in a game.
Absolutely. And I couldn't have said it any better. I love it. We started with sports and ended with sports. That's always a good conversation with me, but in the middle was a lot about leveraging a growth mindset, willingness to leverage technology tools, all really, really good stuff. Bruce, when we get back, well, and sports are up and going again, and the next school year is going on, we'll have to get you back on Tackling Tech to talk sports and talk about social media and professional development building. What do you say?
Sounds great. I'm available anytime.
Awesome. Well, you take it easy and we'll talk to you again real soon.
Thank you very much.
Wow, that was so much fun. I am excited about his book coming out. Definitely we'll be sharing links and information about where you can pick that up. I can't stop thinking about that story with a young John Calipari and Bruce. I'm getting to interact with him early in his career. I love basketball. I'm a huge basketball fan, so that's so much fun. But I think a lot of what he says is super easy and super practical. It's really just putting in the additional work. It is spending time on that. It is keeping yourself open, giving back, and also making a point to try to connect with others. So hope you all enjoy that. Thank you so much for listening to Tackling Tech. If you like what you heard, hit that subscribe button. Give us that 5-star review. We look forward to more episodes in the coming months. Thank you so much for listening. Most importantly, stay safe, and we'll talk to you real soon.